Hey guys, thanks for watching. Sifu Jason. We're back. We're going to finish the dummy form. We're going to finish section 6 and 7. I'm going to put them together and we're going to go over why you can look at it as an application set, because the empty hand forms are giving you the raw material. It's giving you the structural foundations of these applications. And then the dummy form is kind of putting these things in action and kind of telling you how the raw material from the empty hand forms are interacting with an object, right? The object's not moving. If your dummy is moving, you've had too much to drink. So I'm gonna dial that back, okay? But seriously, section 6 and 7, as we wrap this up, as I've said before, you've really got 7 different forms in one form, because you have just 7 sections. But section 6 opens, and it's kind of weird. And when I was younger, nobody explained it to me, which is why I'm doing these videos. I had all these movements I was doing, and I didn't understand what for. So this is one of those things where you look at it and go, what in the devil am I doing? The first opening of this, we call this chain kicking. And part of the idea of the chain kick, the time style with the kick represents that you're kicking while you've got some contact with them. Now, contact in Wing Chun, we're talking bridge. There's a form, Chun Q, seeking the bridge seeking form. Bridge is that contact. That is an area of Wing Chun training that's very misunderstood. And people keep trying to come inside and they're trying to chain punch instead of getting contact and getting control of a guy, or if you will, clinch. So this represents that kind of tie up. And in the wooden dummy form video that we put, the instructional video on our online platform, we cover this more in detail. I'm just going to touch base with it quick. If you want more material on it, obviously, you know, go look at the Teachable platform. But when you get a hold of somebody, you can kind of brace them and then you can kick them. And for some reason or another, a lot of Wing Chun people just forget they have legs. You know, we do chi sao, we do all these things, and we're just not using our feet. But what happens is that once you get the tie-up, you don't have to solve all of your problems with your hands. You're not contractually obligated to do that just because you're doing Wing Chun. So this is giving you the idea of using your feet with your hands. So if I'm getting tied up, I'm jamming the guy, I can try to cross kick him in the knee, I can stomp. You know, this obviously, this leg isn't bending as a human leg would, but this could be seen not just as like an ankle stomp or a shin scraping movement, although you could do that. You could be bending this leg back and trying to snap it. So you can be actually driving into his knee. And if you pin the guy into something, that's what you're doing. You're pinning that leg back and trying to hurt him in such a way that he's not going to bring the fight to you. One note about that is if you do injure somebody's knee and or lower legs, they're not going to be able to function at a high level anymore. So fundamentally, your self-defense job has been completed. And that's good news. You don't have to do any more damage. So that's kind of the first opening idea here. You repeat that, then we hit this section. All right? Now, we have in our program a couple of things that I'm going to share with you. One of the modifications that we use that isn't in the traditional form. But this section, this looks weird because you're thinking a lot of times that this is only a punch. But this could be the guy's head coming in and you're pushing it out of the way. You know, you're trying to come in for a takedown. And we make a modification where if we're trying to do a takedown, we're getting used to moving our feet quick to try to jam that and stop that takedown attempt. A lot of times you're in fighting, the guy tries to get lower than you. And there you go. It can also be referenced, as I always sort of remind guys, if you're in a street fight and somebody's throwing a punch to your body, there is a very good chance there's a weapon involved. He's trying to actually stab you. So getting used to guarding the low line, not in a sport mentality, because that's just going to get you stabbed, but really trying to control that limb is a better way to go. So you do want that in your arsenal. I know a lot of people will probably frown on that. If you're in boxing gyms, you want to keep those elbows in and not be reaching your hands down. And that is true with boxing gloves on. But in real fights, when people go to the body, it's oftentimes because they're trying to actually hit you with a weapon. So that's where this comes in. Now, like I said, this is not in the traditional form. But we're using this to teach people to get out of the way of their legs being attacked. And there's just a little more likelihood of this happening in today's day and age than it was maybe in the 1950s Hong Kong. And I like to tell you, so we teach traditional Ip Man Wing Chun, which is not doing it exactly the way Ip Man did it in the 1950s, because the fighters you're facing are different than the fighters they were facing in the 1950s. So we do want to keep the forms intact to pass them along to the next generation. And we were very careful to always show what modifications we may be using so that the student has the material to make up their own mind. Our job is always to try to get the structures and the principles out and make sure the next generation's strong. So that's where that goes. So this form section six, I'm walking through it, you do that again left side, and then you go and stepping in, and you do it again. Some families just go once and then step in. Some families can go again three times and step in. The stepping in, this is an interesting part of this aspect too, because this really puts you in a position where you could be coming in to punch or hit the ground. We do this a lot. This is actually one of those movements where I put this in the JKD infighting book. I think that the action coming in when you're cross, you're using the pak sao, and you're stepping to the outside, you're keeping your head to the outside, and you're hitting a guy in the bladder, the groin, low abdomen, or this could also be his head. You can be pushing it down and punching him in the face as you're doing this. So it's a really good way to get around and learning how to get off the line and get a little lower. You'll notice I'm actually lowering my center of gravity. So there's a misconception that Wing Chun doesn't have any ducking in it. In the BG form, it's in there, by the way. And it doesn't have that crouch. This is a bit more of a crouch. I don't think you need to be standing straight up with your hips forward and on this section. This is giving you the idea of coming into the inside and crouching and controlling the inside. So you get two great parts of section six that are not in other sections. First, having your hands on somebody, so you have bridge control, and then kicking while you have your hands on somebody. And also how to cover, get to the inside and stay low and begin to hit them from the inside. This also sets up, and we're not going to cover this in this video, but we can do it in some others, but takedowns. I mean, first of all, if you come in, you're getting your leg behind somebody, it's really easy to throw them. I can't throw the dummy. Again, if you're trying to throw your dummy, you gotta dial back whatever it is you're drinking. Don't try to throw your dummy. But with an opponent though, you can get around your leg. And we talk about left to left, back to back, outside, okay? Or right to right, back to back. In other words, if he does left leg forward, swing your left leg around him, and you can do a takedown. This sets you up for it. So section six gives you some really good material there. Plus it's giving you the ability to quickly learn how to check anything coming in low from this gate down. It gets you also the habit of not reaching too far for something coming in. I don't want to be reaching past that line. This teaches me really, this is about the barrier of where I should be going. This is again, got motion, I'm just turning it slightly. You're doing it in the end of Chum Q, and now it kind of interacts with the wooden dummy. So that's a quick overview of section six. As I said, I'm not breaking everything down and giving you full instruction on this. That's a little bit beyond the scope of this video. I want to just kind of alert you to some of the application opportunities you have so that we don't make this mistake of, I think in the one extreme, you have people who are too hyper-traditional and don't want to change the forms, don't want to do anything with them, and you're really going into a museum. You know, you're going in and the Wing Chun is just this thing that used to be, and they don't want to change anything. And you have another approach, which is very dynamic and very application-based, but they diminish the importance of the forms. So forms are the structures and the tactics to practice it and to be able to use it and adapt it to new experiences. So that's why we're bridging the gap. So there's a bit of a balance there. Section seven, again, now going back to a low line assault. So this is the bone style section. Okay, and I'm coming in and I'm going here. Right. So you start right, right, right. I'm going to pause there for that section. Lo Bong Sao, once again, you have the idea in the Chung Q form. What's this motion for? If my hands are down, remember, this is giving us a comprehensive set of ways to deal with attacks that we weren't expecting. Just kind of, how does the Wing Chun system interact with it? Here's a quick thing for you philosophically. If everyone's a philosopher, we talk about here, everyone's a philosopher. It's just most people aren't good at it because they don't want to take the time to think clearly. What we're dealing with is the best way to get an attack is to intercept it and cut it off. You know, guy starts to get mobilized, bang, kick his knee out, punch him, push him, get out of there. But you can't always do that. Something's in the way, there's multiple opponents come in. In this case, I have my hands down. So what we teach here with this system is something I like to refer to as principled pragmatism. Now, people want to be pragmatists. And pragmatism as a test of truth is fine. Pragmatism as a theory of truth is a big disaster because you don't know why something's working. And if a variable changes, you can be in huge trouble. History is full of people who've just made an error of thinking that something that worked before will always work, but the situation changed. All right. So what this is making sure is that we're taking the ideas and covering our bases and going, if this happens, you can do this. If that happens, you can do that. Obviously, I don't want to be as good at dealing with the worst case scenarios, so much to the point where I don't work on my basic punch, kick, and footwork. However, I don't want to become too dependent on that, thinking nothing could ever go wrong. And here's why. I'm not always standing here ready to fight. I could get assaulted where something's coming at my body quick, and that's what Bong Sao is for. I'm not trying to Bong Sao. I'm not going to be in the middle of a fight and have a guy body shot. That's not what Wing Chun's telling you. You're going to use a low Bong Sao against a cross to the body or a kick or something. That's not what it's telling you to do. It's telling you if you are standing here like this, which is kind of common, and something comes after you, that could be an answer. That's all I'm doing. Rotating this off of my trunk. There are other applications for it, but this is one of the most common ones, which is another reason why I don't like teaching students. By the time they get to the dummy, I don't want them to be too formal. I mentioned that in the other videos. I want people coming up and being hyper formal. I'd rather have you more, you know, in a conversational position to get to where you're going. This will help you, incidentally, in your training. When you're learning the form, you have to go through each section and be worried about the sequence. You know, but as you get better, the dummy is your second Sifu. It's going to help you get your positions. It'll help you it'll keep you from becoming too one-dimensional. That's what I said earlier about being principled with your pragmatism. You know, the principles are always true, and then you can apply them to principles, or I'm sorry, to particulars. And so you can start with, you know, this motion. Oh, I can go this way and step around and come in, right? This was in section six. I stepped in and did the motion from section six, but I started in section seven, right? I can go here and then that's section one. Just because the motions are connected sequentially doesn't mean they're connected conceptually. You can mix and match as you go. They're just here for educational purposes. Somebody was talking about, Bruce Lee talked about the classical mess. He was talking about a classical mess while he was in Wing Chun. Isn't that interesting? Bruce Lee was talking about classical mess and classical systems and saying that they were too rigid and unadaptable while he was doing Wing Chun. So I'm not firmly convinced that Bruce Lee considered Wing Chun a classical mess. And I don't think you should either. Don't look at it that way. Don't keep thinking, what does this technique do? Ask, what can it do? What is it? What can it be, rather? Okay? So we're here. Then we back up. Whipping tan, they call it. I'd be very careful with the whipping tan, because you might whip it and crack your hand in the back of an arm. And if you haven't done that, that's painful. It sucks. Don't do that. We're going here. A tan sao is whipping from the low line back up. So once again, it's telling you, giving you Wing Chun's idea of, I'm in a really bad spot. How can I solve the problem? All right. So a really bad spot. How do I solve the problem? Two things going on at once. again, I'm working on being able to defend one line and hit another line, especially that low line. Making sure as you get offline, notice everything going on here. One thing to point out with the footwork is the dummy has now mapped out. This is really the last of the angles of my footwork, where if I've got a clock around, I've been able to go throughout the dummy form. I've been able to go to my 3 o'clock, right? Back to 12 o'clock. I've been able to go to my 9 o'clock, back to 12 o'clock. I've been able to go to my 2 o'clock, back over. I've gone to every spot on this clock. In section 6, I actually went back to my 6 o'clock. So I had to step back slightly to get that kick, facilitate that. And now I'm going over to 7, right? And 5. So you've really been able to move in any direction. So this is so much about footwork. And then it finishes after you've done this. You've got another kick in here. Right there. Once again, you've got a pulling, pushing, and a kick. You're going to have contact with people upstairs, and then they're going to be rigid. They're going to be flipping around. They're going to be doing all this stuff. And you don't want to focus so much on the upstairs line that you forget the kicks. Now, that's the last of the kicks. I mean, some lineages have different sets and so forth. I'm not going to get into that. That's another story for another day. But what I do want to say as we wrap this up is just the wealth of detail that you get. Now, this is wonderful stuff that's been passed down to us through hundreds of years. You know that, right? I mean, we're doing a dummy. We're doing things that have been refined by some great minds over a long period of time. And they've tweaked things as they've gone through them to help adapt to specific environments. That's going back to the philosophy of there's certain true principles. And then there are particulars that keep coming up. And so in philosophy, you call it the question of the one and the many. And what we have is to make sense of things, we have to root them to true principles because the particulars could be changing. And because we have to be adapting to that, how do I know that I know what I know, right? The forms help us go, this is where we're covering all of this ground, right? And that's so important so you can have some confidence to know if something comes up, I just can do it. I have routinely done things over the years that have surprised me. I didn't realize that, oh crap, that came up quick and I just covered it. It wasn't something I planned, but since you've had the training, you're able to pull it off. So there are motions in here that you may not use, but I would still suggest you practice them. Still continue to keep your basic footwork, punch and kick at the top of your food chain, so to speak, but keep practicing these things because when you need them, you really need them. Some of these things are, like I said again, not as used, not as common, but they're like your fire extinguisher. When you need it, you really need it. And so this is helping us become keeping us from becoming too dependent upon training things. I'm gonna say it this way, is every school has, you know, some of us love chi sao, some of us love sparring, some of us love forms. It's very easy to rely too much on one thing. Everything is a prescription. And I'm going to do a video later, it'll be coming up, look for it, on one of the great mistakes of and side effects of too much chi sao. It's, you know, because again, everything has an advantage, but it's a prescription. And like any prescription, it has a side effect. And so one of the side effects of doing this is you can become too technical, right? But one of the side effects of sparring, and I was there for a while when I was boxing too much, I saw everything from a boxing standpoint, and I thought, oh, if I was a good boxer, that means I was a good self-defender, and that wasn't necessarily true. Unfortunately, I didn't pay dearly with that misunderstanding, but I did run into some scenarios that I could have performed much better, and I kind of lucked out not getting hurt worse because I had too much of a sporting mentality. So the dummy form is unique in that it takes the Wing Chun empty hand forms and it applies them to a particular here. And this particular isn't moving and it's built a certain way. And so now the empty hand forms look different. So that's going to tell you that when you start interacting with different people moving around, Wing Chun is going to look different still. All right. But this is also going to teach you mechanics to be able to handle things that might come up, a particular that you couldn't plan for. That's the advantage of this. is teaching you to deal with things that you don't even know what's going on. Imagine if you could go into the future and find out what was going to come up. Let's imagine right now that you can you have some kind of app on your phone that can find out it takes your thumbprint or an eye scan or something, and it says, and it could determine that 5 years from now, you're going to be attacked by three guys in a parking lot at like 7 p.m. at X, Y, Z, right? You go, oh, okay, I got to be prepared for that. The dummy is help is the next best thing. Since you don't know what the future is, you want to be able to cover your bases to have an ability to handle a diversity of attacks. Like I keep saying, the particulars. You don't know what the particulars are. This is a martial art. It is not a martial sport. A martial sport, you go in and you absolutely can train in the thing, apples to apples, what you'll be competing against. When I have boxers come in, they can box, so they can find out if they're a good boxer. As self-defenders, this is why a martial art is important, is it's giving you a diversity of training experiences so that you're able to handle the particulars as they come up. I hope that makes sense. I hope that wasn't too philosophical for you, but that's one of the reasons why I love this, and you become a philosopher of the fist when you're learning a real martial art, as opposed to, you know, just going in and getting in better shape. You know, I see ads all the time. It's like, you know, you're getting better shape. And it's true. I've met some of my greatest friends. I mean, the cameraman's one of my best friends. These guys, this is great, and I love being here. But the bottom line, this is a martial art. It needs to be there for us if we need martial, warlike art. Somebody's trying to kill us or hurt us really bad. And I can't always dictate how that's going to happen because it's not a sport. That's why there's stuff like this. So that's why you have seven forms, seven sections of one form. So you have seven little forms. And then once you get these down, start playing with them. You may find the way you move and the things that come up, you might need to focus more on one thing than another for a little while. But do work the whole form. Because if you don't, that's when you leave out. And all of us have done this. Is that's why you need a system. All right, boys and girls, you need a system. Because the tendency for all of us is to do the one or two things we're really good at and not do anything else. And part of life, part of adulting well, is making sure that we don't have our limitations exceed our capacities through negligence. What we want is our capacities to exceed the limitations by making sure we're balanced. So good forms passed down by very wise people who have vetted this stuff is gonna really will help us not to become too one-dimensional and too over-reliant on things that we're just talented with. And then we come up with an entire epistemology, an entire philosophy of, well, this is the way fights go. I love when people, this is the way fights go. That's why I always keep telling you guys, fights and principles, fights are unpredictable. Fights can be in any type of environment against any type of number of people. There could be weapons, there may not be weapons, multiple points of time, we don't know. I'm giving you principles and then particulars flow out of that. So be very careful when people say, oh, unless we see it here, you know, unless a guy's doing MMA, he's not really a fighter. You know, that ask any soldier, there's certain training and the training needs to be diversified so that these guys are adaptable because you can't control the conditions a fight will happen. That's why a martial art has to have this unity and diversity. If that makes sense. I know it's a lot of philosophy, but, I got all of that out of the dummy form. So that's one of the reasons I love it, because it's still, here I am, 51 years old. I've been doing this since I was 11, and, I'm still learning things about it every day. You know, when I was young and I had all this hubris and the energy of youth, and I was getting into Wing Chun, I thought, oh, when I get older, I'm going to make it better. And now I'm like, nah, they did a pretty good job with it. All I'm still doing is unpacking it. You know, and I'm so grateful. People say, you know, thank you so much. You're really teaching well. And my whole goal is to try to tell you guys the things I wish I knew when I was learning. You know, I was doing a lot of movements, and sometimes I'm like, what the heck am I doing this for? I'm never going to do this in a fight. And I wish somebody would have told me some of those things. And I'll wrap it up with this, is that by doing the form is your best friend. You're like Daniel painting the fence. Because you're going to have this movement there when you need it. And you don't know when you need it until you need it. It's like that fire extinguisher, okay? But if you wait until you need it to figure out how to do it, you're really in big trouble. And that's the part of discipline. And so that's why when people say, martial arts will teach you discipline, yes, it'll teach you humility. You can't have real discipline without humility. Humility tells you, you're fallible. You're human and you're not in charge of everything, right? That's one of the things that gets under my skin about some of the martial art heroes, is that they seem to know everything. I mean, they're not omniscient. That's you know, that's nonsense. This teaches me humility, because I'm like, I don't know how a fight's going to go. And my body's changing. I'm different now at my age now than I was 10 years ago or 10 years before that. And so having a system has helped me adapt even as I've aged. If I was simply doing a more combat sport oriented thing, I'm not the same athlete I was when I was 25. And so that's why you need a system. So that is, again, my sales pitch for why you should be doing Wing Chun as your martial art. It's so intellectually, philosophically fulfilling and practical in principle. It's principled and pragmatic at the same time, you know? So I hope you enjoyed this. And as I wrap up the Wooden Dummy series, section 6 and 7, let me know if you've got any questions and check it out. If you want to know more in-depth details, the nuts and bolts, we've got that course online, so you can check that out. Please do. You know, we love our Extended Academy family. And again, one last thing. I just want to thank everybody in the Wing Chun community. I love Wing Chun, as you can tell, and it's been great for me. And I hope that you're enjoying it where you are. And this has helped you through some tough COVID lockdowns. A lot of people have been messaging us and saying, thank you so much, because I can't get in and train. If you don't have a dummy, I'm sorry, but you can't work the air dummy. And if you can't get one, and if you're in an apartment, get one and rattle the crap out of it to really irritate your neighbors. And then you won't have a place to stay because you get evicted. Hey, never mind. But seriously, if you've got a dummy, it's the next best thing than having a training partner. And it's a training partner never gets tired. And it can continue to teach you better angles and make you a better martial artist, a better Wing Chun man or woman. So all that said, hope you enjoyed the video. Hope this really helped. And I hope you enjoyed the jokes and the info. And let me know if you have any questions or comments. Please click like and subscribe. Click like and subscribe. And if you don't, something bad will happen. The hook will keep falling out of your dummy arm and you're going to lapse out and fall over. Somebody, have you seen this? And it's stuff? People get mad at me saying I'm speaking negative. It's a joke, people. It's just a joke. Okay. So negativity. I know some cultures, you get really irritated with that. I apologize for that. I'm just trying to supersede the general sense of ego and chest pounding that goes along with the martial arts stuff out there, and just relax. We're all humans, and violence happens a lot of times because of ego and pride. And so we should be doing that. I don't mean anything bad for those of you who've had a problem with my, click like or subscribe or else. But seriously, you should, because if you don't, I'm kidding. Okay. Never mind. I'll stop. Anyway, by the way, last thing, I know I'm rambling here, but somebody from Britain sent me an email and told me that they love this stuff and whatever. And they've learned one thing is that Yanks. I love it when the English calls us Yanks. That's so cool. He's like that some Yanks have a zany sense of humor too. Like, that was awesome. That was fantastic. That was the best compliment I think I've ever had. Yeah. Okay. So, anyway, hope all of this helps. Check us out online. We're on Facebook, Greenville Academy on Facebook. So we've got some more internal school stuff on there, but, you know, click the, follow page or like, I don't know what you got to do. And I'm actually on Instagram. Follow that too. Okay. I don't know what's going on over there either, but, we'll catch you guys next time.